as Joint Honor Guard. Please remain standing for the singing of the National Anthem by Dr. Elston Steele of the Countering Weapons of Mass Destruction Office, and an invocation by Commander Ken Espinoza, Deputy Chaplain for the United States Coast Guard.
And you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fights, oh, the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave? Oh, the land of the free and the home of the brave.
Color, right shoulder, arm.
Good afternoon. Let us pray. Gracious and merciful God, in your sovereignty and love, you saw fit to raise men and women alike, leaders who would answer the call to protect our homeland and instill a culture of relentless resilience that inspires thousands even today. For 20 years, the Department of Homeland Security has remained steadfast in ensuring our way of life and values remain safe, secure, and blessed. These Americans have continually sought to consider others more important than self. I ask now that your hand of favor would continue to rest on those who stand the watch, that your word of peace would ring in the hearts of those we serve, and that your watchful eye would ever be upon this great nation. As we gratefully reflect on the past 20 years, let us now take a moment of silence and remember our brothers and sisters whose sacrifice indeed left a legacy of service. Amen. Please be seated.
Please welcome U.S. Secretary of Homeland Security Alejandro N. Mayorkas.
Good morning. Good morning. On November 19th, 2002, the senior senator from Delaware voted in support of the act to create the United States Department of Homeland Security. In the years preceding that vote and the years since, Joe Biden has worked for the safety and security of our country and the well-being of every American. The walk to this podium may be short, but it represents a lifetime of service. 36 years as a United States Senator, 8 years as the Vice President of the United States, and now as our President. Through it all, we have had no greater champion of our department and our mission. We are deeply honored on our 20th anniversary to be joined by the 46th President of the United States of America. Everyone, please rise and give a warm welcome to President Biden.
All right, fellas. Please, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. You're very nice, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Please, please sit. I don't know who Ali was talking about, someone being around that long. 20 years. Whoa. You know, when we voted to set you all up, no one ever thought it'd be over 260,000 people. No one thought it'd take up, but you've done an incredible job. Mr. Secretary, I came for a simple reason, to say thank you. Thank you for welcoming me back here today, as well as 20 years. Mr. Secretary, you're a true patriot, as dedicated your career to protecting and serving the American people while upholding our nation's laws and standing up for American values. Because when I think of this department, I think of it in that way, standing up for American values. I'm so grateful for everything, Mr. Secretary, you've done and all of you do for our country and for the whole world. You know, every 9/11, I think about a friend of mine named Davis Cessna from Delaware. The year before 9/11, I was watching television in my, was it the summer? I was watching television in my recreation room, looking at my grandkids in the swimming pool. And all of a sudden, they broke in and they showed someone sitting on the banks of the Delaware and Chesapeake Canal, or the C&D Canal, Chesapeake and Delaware Canal. And he had his head in his hands, and they said that he had just lost his youngest son because what happened was the boat, the small boat they had, hit a piling that was just below the water. The child was down in the hull, down by the hull, and anyway, he died. And he picked up the phone. He was dialing the phone. And as I watched him dial the phone, my phone rang. He was calling me to tell me what had just happened and ask what he should do. And then a year later, I was with him on 9/11. Not with him. I was near him on 9/11 when he got a phone call. His oldest son was just 6 days into a job on the 104th floor of the South Tower of the World Trade Center. And Davis went straight to ground zero in search of his son and searched deep into the last, as he called it, innings of hope, as he put it. And a few days later, after they finally found that his son was there and had died, I got a call from Davis. And we talked as fathers. I had lost several kids earlier, a long story, but we were talking as dads, and I didn't understand. I didn't have the loss he had, but I did lose a wife and a child. and in an accident. And it was I was on my way when he calls to speak to students at the University of Delaware to talk about 9/11. And there are several thousand students to try to set the record, not straight, but to calm things down a little bit. And to make some sense out of the new world we're in. And I told him where I was going. And he said over the phone, he said, just tell them. Just tell them. I'll never forget what he said. Don't be afraid. He said, don't be afraid. Tell them that. It's extraordinary. Yet the most ordinary of American things. Don't be afraid. To know that life can be unfair and uncertain, a cruel twist of an accident, a deliberate act of evil. But even in the darkness, there still should be light. Don't be afraid. Fight back. Not let the terrorists define us or fundamentally change our way of life. But to stand up, to fear, and to make sure that Americans can still live their lives and dream their dreams. That's what all of you represent from my perspective. Letting Americans live their lives, still dream their dreams. The Department of Homeland Security is formed out of the tragedy of 9/11, to repeat myself, but with an unshakable resolve of a sacred mission to secure our country and to protect the American people. Today, work of DHS is important, as important as it's ever been. I would argue it's even more important than it's been up to now. The fact is, you have 260,000 employees, including 20% of you are veterans, continuing to serve your nation, preventing terror attacks domestically and globally, protecting our air, our land, our maritime borders, helping the global partners that we have do the same thing, responding in an instant to natural disasters. We've flown all over the country with the head of FEMA. We've been to more states than we'd like to acknowledge now with fire, drought, devastation. With the climate crisis, we're asking more of you every single day, with extreme weather impacting communities and mounting frequency and ferocity, all the while helping our people cope with public emergencies like the collapsed condo in Florida, which no one had ever anticipated, growing greater resilience in our communities through violent prevention programs. And by the way, I see your incredible work every single day with the brave women and men of the United States Secret Service, vigilantly protecting my family, the Vice President's family, former presidents, visiting world leaders in events of national consequence. Every day, the people of this department are also working to preserve the integrity of our elections, protect our critical infrastructure from physical and cyber attack. I'm going to keep making sure you have the resources you need to do the job, because your job is so expansive across the board. In fact, I was able to secure record funding for DHS, and I'm asking Congress to do more. In the 20 years since DHS began, the world has become more interconnected, more complicated than ever, and new threats are emerging with incredible advances in technology. Some are frightening, those advances. Many are reassuring. But yet, because of you, America is safer, is stronger, and is better prepared to meet whatever threat we face. And the threats are mounting. They're not diminishing. But we have you. And I know the stakes and the stress of the job take an incredible toll. Yet every single one of you answer the call every day. It's not hyperbole to suggest you're heroes, you're patriots, possess a rare commitment, a rare commitment to your fellow Americans, showing the American people how their government works for them. You give them confidence. You represent the best of us. Duty, devotion, courage, honor, service before self. It's truly noble. While I'm speaking to you, the leaders here, there's so many people out in the field putting their lives at risk as I speak to you. As we commemorate 20 years of this remarkable department and all its key elements, so many I can't mention all of them in one moment. Coast Guard, Secret Service, FEMA, the Transportation Security Administration, Customs and Border Patrol, Immigration, Customs Enforcement, and U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Services, Cybersecurity, Infrastructure, Security Agency, the Federal Enforcement and Training Center. On behalf of the American people, and I mean this, on behalf of the American people, I came for a simple reason, Leslie, to say thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. American people know you're there, but they have no idea just how many of you there are, how many people put their lives on the line every day for you. And we owe you. You know, on this day, we also honor those who gave the full devotion of to their nation and serving in this department. We remember them. You got to remember them all. It matters. Because unlike in other engagements, many of them don't get to be known, don't get to be celebrated. We also know this is not just the person who works the job, who serves, it's the whole family. And that's the part I think that we sometimes underestimate. You know, there's a line from the English poet John Milton, I've quoted before, said, "They also serve who only stand and wait." They also serve who only stand and wait. We owe your family so damn much. So damn much. They have a sense of what you're doing. They know some of it in detail, the chances you're taking. But every day, every time you walk out of that house, that door closes behind you. They wonder. And they serve. So I thank your families who had to stand and wait. So they're hoping their loved ones will come home just as they left the door. They serve as well. I think maybe that's the hardest part for most of you, is knowing what your family is facing. There's no greater responsibility for government than ensuring the safety of the American people and those who serve and protect us all. On behalf of the American people, I want to thank you. I mean it from the bottom of my heart. Thank you for your service. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I know it's a small thing, but we mean it. And I don't think they get to see your faces, get to know who you are, have any idea all the risks so many of you take. It's important they know. So God bless the patriots of the Department of Homeland Security, and may God keep all of the folks you have in the field safe and secure. Because we need them. We need them badly. Again, thank you, thank you, thank you.
What an incredible honor and opportunity to hear from the President of the United States today. At this time, please direct your attention to the screen behind me for two very special messages.